Good evening to everyone present here, and I welcome you all to the Wednesday study circle meeting today. And today we have a session on HUF taxation aspects. Let me welcome the speakers and the chairman of Bangalore branch, Madam CA Geeta AB. Can you kindly escort the speaker Pallavi and Saraswati to the dais? Can you give a round of applause? Can I ask Madam to welcome her with a floral bouquet?
Define the Hindu undivided family. So term Hindu undivided family is not defined under the Income Tax Act. And hence the various court, including Supreme Court, has held that Hindu undivided family, to understand the term Hindu undivided family, we have to understand, it has to be construed in the sense which has been understood under the Hindu law. So under the Hindu law, how the HUF has been evolved. So concept of Hindu undivided family, as we all know, it's an ancient, it has come from the ancient Hindu philosophy. It's a, the way the people were living, it's a system. The people, the ancient people were living. So Hindu law has been derived from our Smritis, Shrutis and customs, and thereafter scholars have developed commentaries and digests. And based on that commentaries or difference of opinion on certain aspects, two school of thoughts have been evolved. One is Mitakshara school of law and other is Dayabhaga school of law. I won't get into much details of these two schools, what are the difference, but I will touch upon what is the major difference in this two school of Hindu law. So the major difference is in right of co-partionaries. So co-partionary under the Mitakshara school of thought, the co-partionary rights person gets by birth, whereas in case of Dayabhaga school, the person who is a co-partner or son will get the right only on the demise of the father. So that is the main difference as far as co-partionary right is concerned. Understanding this, after that, Hindu law, various post-independence, the various Hindu laws were there, which is practiced by way of custom. But then post-independence or pre-independence era, many laws has been codified. And these are the major law which are Hindu laws which has been codified in the parliament. It covers marriage, Hindu marriage act, Succession Act, which has been significantly amended by Hindu Succession Amendment Act, Hindu Minority and Guardian Act, Adoption and Maintenance Act, and Women's Right and Property Act. We won't be discussing on this law while we are dealing with the Hindu undivided family, but the important thing is the Hindu Succession Act, and which we would touch upon because it is connected with this our topic. So whom this Hindu undivided family will apply? Who can form the Hindu undivided family or HUF? So Hindu undivided family, as we name suggests, it applies to all the Hindus. So the person who has been raised as Hindu, is Hindu law is applicable, and it includes deemed Hindus like Buddhists, Sikhs and Jains. However, it excludes Muslims, Christians, Parsis and Jews. Muslims, certain communities of Muslims like Kachi, Memon, Bohras, they can be governed by, or they can choose to govern by Hindu Succession Act. However, still they won't be able to form HUF because they are not Hindus. So even though they are governed by, they choose to govern by Hindu Succession Act, they cannot form valid HUF. So every Hindu family is an HUF itself. So the question arises whether person who has born to a parent, the one person, mother is a Christian and parent, father is a Hindu, in that case, whether the person, child would be regarded as a Hindu or no. So in this connection, the Supreme Court has held, what we have to see whether father is Hindu or mother is Christian, rather than seeing that, what is important aspect is whether the child has been raised as Hindu or no. So if the child has been raised as Hindu, then the child would be regarded as a Hindu. Similarly, if the person who is a Hindu but has converted himself into a different religion, then he won't be regarded as Hindu, and hence HUF won't be applicable. He can't form a HUF. Now, there are other aspects which we can consider is Hindu undivided family. Like, you know, it's a creation of law. it's not nobody can like it's not a act of parties like AOP, Association of Persons, or partnership firm or a company which a person can create. In case of Hindu undivided family, you cannot create by act of parties. It's by law. It is by law. So the only exception is adoption. In case of adoption, it requires action by parties. So when the person adopts a child or there is a reunion, then there is a case of formation of HUF by act of parties. Otherwise, on the marriage, the HUF is automatically created. HUF can be put to end by the act of parties. So these are some aspects. Now we can discuss Hindu Succession Amendment Act 2005. Before we discuss, just to give a genesis, why this amendment was required could be a political, but we won't discuss what was the issue. But it gives now, it has removed the gender discrimination between a girl child and a son. So daughter and son now are on equal footing with this amendment. The reason could be for this amendment is that dowry, in the past, when the marriage happens, father used to give him either by custom dowry or lot of gifts on marriage. That has now legally banned. So therefore, so the daughter doesn't get otherwise which she used to get at the time of marriage. She is not now getting any property or rights in the father's property. So this, and now with coming to nucleus family and the system, culture, everything has changed. So now we see a lot of daughters taking care of parents. So this Hindu Succession Amendment Act is a good footing which helps to remove gender discrimination and gives equal right as son. So what are the rights which this amendment has given to woman is daughter of co-partner shall by birth become a co-partner in her own right at the same manner as son. So she will have the same share in the co-partner property or father's property. She will get equal share. She will have the same right as son as if she is born as son. Then she can seek a partition of the dwelling house. She can also dispose her share in co-partnery property at her own will. And lastly, a widow of the deceased son, even though she gets remarried, is now eligible to get the share in the property of the legal heir of the predeceased son of the family. So now let us understand the two important concepts in the HUF, or co-partners and members of HUF. Who are considered as a co-partner and who will be considered as a members? So co-partnery is a narrower term, whereas members is a wider term. So co-partnery includes a four degree of succession. So from common male ancestor, it has to be a lineal descendant from a common male ancestor. So it will include person himself, his son, his grandson, and great grandson. Now, from as we see that Hindu Succession Amendment Act has been amended in 2005. Now, daughter also becomes a co-partner. So daughter also be a co-partner. Whereas members includes mother, wife, widows, and of course unmarried daughters till before 2005. So after 2005, the daughters are regarded as a co-partners. What are the rights of co-partners and members? Co-partners has wider rights. Apart from right to right of maintenance, the co-partner has right to claim partitions, whereas members only has a right to receive a right to maintenance. And on partitions, co-partner will have a equal shares, whereas members will members doesn't get an equal share, but it's a right to receive a reasonable share. And in case a wife of karta or mother where father has died, and then in that circumstances she will get, she has a right to receive equal share as one co-partner. Now let us do one case study. Mrs. A, born on 3rd September 1972, and she got married in 2004. She has one brother, born in 1980. Her father has HUF. Now, can she become a co-partner as she was born and married before the enactment of Hindu Succession Act? Because Hindu Succession Act, which gives a right to daughter, has come in force from 1st September 2005. So, any views on that? Can she become a co-partner?
Post-marriage?
Yeah.
Post-marriage. Once she gets married, she gets into the other family.
Any other views?
She gets married after the date. Huh. Actually becomes a co-partner.
So she has become, she got married before this enactment of the Hindu Succession Act. So there was a Bombay High Court decision where in case of Vaishali Satish Ganorkar, where the Bombay High Court has held that the female born after 1st September 2005 only will be, this amendment will apply only if the person or female has born after this date. Before that date, if the female has born, then this act doesn't apply to her. But later on, this decision has been reversed by the Bombay High Court full bench, and Bombay High Court has relied on Orissa and Karnataka High Court decision and has held that this, even the female has born before the amendment or before the date of enactment of Hindu Succession Act, she will become a co-partner. Now the only challenge we have, or where we have need to have a more discussion, is okay, she will become a co-partner, but at the time of enactment she got married, so will she get equal right, or will she be regarded as a co-partner because she was not a member of the father's family at the time of enactment? So there could be two views. One is that we have to see the status as on the 1st September 2005. So as on the 1st September 2005, she was not a member of that, because pre-enactment era, the daughter is a member, unmarried daughter will be a member of father's HUF. But once she gets married, she becomes a member of her husband's HUF. So as on that day, she was not a member, so she cannot become a co-partner. The other view is that since the Hindu Succession Act is operative and it gives the right from the date of birth, so it goes, she gets a right since she has born. So even though she is married, she will get, she will become, it doesn't impact her status as a co-partner, and she can become a co-partner of her father's HUF. And one of the Kolkata tribunal decisions, while they were discussing on the applicability of deemed dividend, there they have discussed these issues, and they said that it is irrelevant whether on the date of enactment the female is married or unmarried. So one can rely on that decisions. Of course, the possibility of other rules cannot be ruled out. Now the second question we have is, will the answer differ? Like, you know, assuming that we go with the view that she can become a co-partner, will our view will differ if the father has passed away in 2003, that is before the enactment of Hindu Succession Act?
And before her marriage date.
The marriage thing we have concluded, it doesn't. So, what Hindu Succession Act says that since her father is no longer is on that day, so there is no family or HUF as on that day. It has been she cannot form HUF or she cannot be a co-partner with brother only. So their father has to be there as on the day when this enactment has happened. So now let us discuss what are the rights, interests and rights and liabilities of the co-partners. So co-partners interest. So as we discussed, like, you know, Mitakshara family, generally the co-partner interest is not fixed because they get right as they since they born. So it's a fleeting family body and there is no fixed right. So if it rights gets increased if somebody from the family passes away, or his right can be decreased if there is a new member has been added in the family. So right interest in that family property is not a fixed. Other interesting point is that a third party's right to take possession over the property along with rest of co-partnery is limited. So it means that if the one co-partner wants to leave and sell his shares, or like, you know, he wants to say that, you know, my property or my share, I want to give it to, I want to sell it off, then the other co-partner can will have a preemptive right. So they can stop the third person and buy that share from the other co-partner. So this is the co-partner will have a preemptive right. Right, then?
That means a partial partition is recognized under income tax? No.
No, we'll discuss that. We'll discuss that.
It's a question.
Yeah. So when we come to partial partitions, we'll discuss in detail. So co-partners have right over the family property in case of partition and can seek the partition at any time and demand his share in the family property. Liability, what are the liabilities of the co-partner? If the debts are incurred by karta in the ordinary course of business in the interest of family, then all the co-partners become jointly liable to the extent of their share in the family property. And if any act which is contrary to the interest of family is done by karta of the HUF or other co-partner was also party to such contract, then they will become personally liable to such debt.
Last point, a person will act contrary to the interests of the HUF. He may not have such wishes, but it turns out to be negative. Then what happens? The other people say we are not party to it.
Yeah. So it's in family. It will always, like, no. If there is a liability, other person will say that, like, no, you have not acted in the. So he has to demonstrate that circumstances and see.
It's not a willful thing.
So who is karta? Generally, karta means the person who does or who is managing. So karta is the person who manages the affairs of the family. Normally, he is the senior most person of the family. So father would be generally karta of that family. But it's not necessary. If the karta passes away, then the next line of heir can be karta, and karta can renounce his right to become part karta. So senior most member can renounce his right and say that I don't want to become a karta. In that case, other co-partners can become a karta. Even the junior member also become a karta if with the consent of other members. Wife or widow of the co-partner cannot be karta. This is mainly because to become a karta, the main qualification is that person should be a co-partner. So co-partner, wife or a widow or mother is not a co-partner. So if they don't qualify to become karta. Minor can be karta, but through his legal guardian. And as we seen that Hindu Succession Act has been amended, so now daughter also is a co-partner and hence she also can be a karta.
Second point, normally it is seen as male member of the family. Last point says daughter can also be.
So this is what we see, that normally male member becomes a karta, normally. Okay, but it is not a thumb rule. So as I said, senior most, then even the junior person also can become a karta, and daughter also can become a karta. So it will be through the consent of members, but generally we see the eldest in the family, main member, as a karta. But there is no debug that female or daughter cannot be karta or junior member cannot be karta. So if the karta sees that this junior person has more, he is more experience and he can handle that, or due to ill health or whatever reason he sees that I cannot manage, in that case he can renounce, he can say that I don't want to be karta, let other person take active part. Now let us see what are the powers karta has. Karta has very wide power to manage the family properties. He is the controller and custodian of the finance, and he is not liable to submit accounts to anybody, but he is required to act in the interest of the family. He can borrow the money on behalf of HUF, he can invest, he can suomoto, make partitioning of the family and determine the quantum, who will get what share. He can do that also. HUF cannot enter into a contract or a partnership, become a partner in the partnership firm, but however through karta it can represent. We will discuss more in details when we come to the later slide. Karta can gift away movable properties of HUF of natural love, out of natural love and affection, but it has to be within a reasonable limit. He can transfer immovable property, but only for the pious purpose or for the benefit of family. So for immovable property, there are a lot of restrictions. It requires consent of all the members before transferring the immovable properties. And karta can act in the dual capacity, and so one as a karta and other is as a member, and he can claim a remunerations and other benefits as a manager of the HUF. Now let us take one more case study. Mr. A constitute a HUF along with his spouse, younger brother and their spouses and their children. Now at the same time Mr. A also constitute another HUF along with his wife and children. So can he be considered as a karta of both the HUF, or can he become karta of both the HUF? Yes, absolutely. He can be karta of both the HUF. The only thing one has to take care is when they have, from income tax purpose, because both the entities would be filing the return, there has to be some identification. Generally we see the karta, generally we see the HUF name is the name of the karta HUF. Right? Suppose Mr. XY is there, HUF. That way the name of the title is given to that HUF.
Okay. Necessary, HUF need not be there. XYZ also can be
mentioned. Yeah.
HUF need not be there.
No, HUF from income tax perspective, we are saying we generally to show the demarcation that it is an individual, and HUF we see.
Demarcation comes in the form itself when you take. So why name HUF should come? I think that is the wrong concept which has been we are promoting. Not necessary. I am finding form. Without
the
HUF.
Okay. That's all.
Yeah. You are taking member HUF. That serves the purpose. Why HUF should come along with the name?
That's a practical insight.
Yeah, practically. Good insight. Yes. So there could be a family and there could be a sub-branches of that family. So one, the earlier the, where he is constituting HEF with his brothers and spouses of brothers and children, it's a bigger HEF, whereas the later one is a smaller HEF, which is himself, his spouse and children. And this is what the concept has been blessed even in the case of M.M. Khanna by the Bombay High Court, that there could be a bigger HEF and there could be a branches of the family within that HEF. So here again the same example has been given, that if a person has a wife and son, they constitute an HEF. If the son have wives and children, they will also constitute HEF. If the grandson also has wives and children, they will also constitute still smaller or sub-branch of HEF. So HEF is a creation of law, and these entities are HEF along with bigger HEF, which also includes the smaller HEF within that. And it is not material whether that smaller HEF has a property or no. Even if they don't have a property, they still be a HEF. So we'll be discussing a lot in the subsequent slides about HEF property. So let us understand what constitutes the HEF property. So below are the properties which are recognized as a co-partnership property or family property. So ancestral property. Ancestral property means a property which a person has got from either from his father or from his grandfather or great grandfather, and it is not in the capacity of individual but in the capacity as a family. So these are called ancestral property. Now ancestral property, if the person is getting property or property from collateral relations like uncle or maternal grandfather, those properties will not qualify as an ancestral property. Property received by him at the time of partitions, like we have seen the bigger HEF and smaller HEF, branch of HEF. So from bigger HEF, if the person is getting at the time of partition, any property has been allotted, so that property also becomes a HEF property of him. The third type is jointly acquired by the co-partner. All co-partners have jointly put the efforts and money and labor and acquired this property as a co-partner. Separate property of a co-partner has been thrown into a common hodgepodge. So when self-acquired property has been considered or thrown into family hodgepodge and treated as a co-partnership property, it becomes a HEF property. Even the property which has been which is brought back on after partition, when reunion happens and property brought back, that property also becomes a part of HEF property. Now, how will
jointly acquired by the co-partners means what?
So
four individuals buy a property, say four brothers,
then
becomes
the HEF
property.
So all people, like who are co-partners of that HEF. Okay. So from HEF money, or they have a business. So from that business, they have funded this property. So when they bought this property, the intention was not to hold this property as a co-owner, but it is a co-family property. So because co-ownership, then you are determining your share in that property. So you are, when you are buying the property, you are saying that it is a family property and I won't be taking this property as a co-owner property.
Excuse me, so in the previous slide where you are saying the second last point, separate property of a co-partner thrown into the family hodgepodge. So
it becomes that.
So I am saying that a member of or a co-partner, month on month he is, let's say, making some money. And that money, let us say, just for the example, let's say he is buying shares. And or rather he is getting salary. Now this salary, whatever he is saving is, he transfer it to the HUF account. And in HUF account, if we buy shares, it becomes the shares of the HUF, right?
Right. But then the implications, there will be implications of throwing self-acquired property into HUF watch, we'll discuss that. So, post-amendment of Hindu Succession Act, on the death of Hindu, his interest in the family property shall devolve by succession and not by the survivorship. And that succession can be testamentary, that is by will, or intestate, that is without will. If the person has made the will, then property distribution will happen as per will. It can be as per his wish, as mentioned in the will. If there is no will, then it will go by the succession rules as provided in the Hindu Succession Act. So, if the person is receiving property from his father under the Hindu Succession Act, then that property would be his individual property and not a family property or HUF property. And in that case, any income received or earned on that property would be taxed in his individual hand and not in the HUF capital's hand. Now, after this, let us discuss what are the formations, let me know how we form the HUF and partitions. So, to constitute an HUF, there has to be a two members. One person or one co-partner cannot form a HUF. The funda is very simple. It says Hindu undivided family. Family cannot consist of one person. It has to have a plurality. So one person or one member or co-person cannot form an HUF. However, it is not necessary also that it should have two male members. One co-person is enough. Now, HUF may consist of single male member, widows and widows of the deceased members, or single male members with wife and daughters. So even the son is not there, the daughter is there, still the HUF is valid. Or only husband and wife is there, HUF is valid. Okay. There are various, on the constitution of HUF, there are various decisions, and we'll discuss those decisions. So, it is not necessary that a family which should have a father, mother, if father, mother has passed away and only brothers, sisters are there, they can also still be a valid HUF between brothers and sisters. Okay.
Isn't it dissolved once the father is passed?
No. So family was there, HUF is there. Now they have passed away. So they will continue brother with the brothers and sisters.
Same
HUF
will continue.
Brothers and sisters. Is it necessary that all of them should be?
Yeah. Okay. All of them should be. Now, in case of husband and wife, they don't have a child, and then husband passes away. In that case, widow also can, the HUF will continue in the hands of widow if she adopts a child after the death of.
During the intermittent period.
Yeah.
She adopts after 3 years down the line.
Right.
Then, during those 3 years, she will be assessed as an individual. This income from the
Correct. So what in the next illustration or next decision we have discussed, that where there is only sole surviving partner is left, other co-partners or members are not there, only one person is there. So in that case, the single person cannot form an HUF. So this income will be assessed as an individual income till he marries. So once he marries, that property or HUF again will be revived and it will be assessed in the hands of as a HUF. Now, mode of creations of HUF or creations of assets of HUF. So there are various ways in which HUF properties can be created. The most popular is gift and will. So, we'll discuss gift and will more detail. So, HUF can receive gift from members, co-partners or non-members also. There is no bar that HUF cannot receive gifts from outsiders. HUF can receive gifts from outsiders also. The important thing is that gift from members will not be income, will not be income under the in the hands of HUF under section 56.2.10. However, the income on from such property would be taxed in the hands of individual who has transferred or gifted this money as per the provision of 64.2. So to answer your queries, he can transfer and buy shares in the name of HUF, but any income earned from that investment would be taxed in the hands of HUF, and we will discuss in more details in the subsequent slide about the clubbing provisions.
How can it be assessed in the hands of the
club? Yeah, HUF. In the hands of individual.
How can it be assessed in the hands of the HUF? What is thrown?
In the hands of individual.
And it will be assessed only in individual. Whatever is thrown into power.
Correct.
That will be assessed with the respect partition.
Interest, income earned on that money or property transfer. Yes. That income would be clubbed in his individual head. So you are saying it's a sole co-partner.
Only
one person is a co-partner. Yeah. So as I mentioned earlier, so if the person is only sole co-partner, then all the income earned by that sole co-partner will be assessed in his individual capacity.
I mean, there is no succession that comes in once in case he or she goes for marriage.
Yeah. So once he gets married, then that property can recharacterize as a HUF property, but till that time, that property will be assessed in his individual capacity because he has full right to dispose it of.
Suppose when he is alone, he says, "I completely partition the HUF. Effectively, it is himself only, and entire thing goes to him. So it is over. After that, it is not possible even
so
if he is
married." So it will be by his intention. Yeah.
But succession act, in case suppose if he goes for marriage and then the successor comes in, properties, the status would be what exactly? Will it be an individual property? Will it be a previous achievement property?
It will be like a reunion.
So once he says that like, this property is mine,
it has been
considered as an individual property. So he doesn't want to treat this as a HUF after the marriage.
My doubt
is
on the
side,
it is subsequent date if
the
successor comes in.
Yeah.
And the property is still existing, then
the
successor will have a right
to that property. Yeah, so under the Hindu Succession Act, son or daughter will have a right to receive that property by way of succession.
Under HUF law, yes, but not under income tax. Income tax is partitioned by medicine bounds, so it is over. But so far as HUF law, it will be different.
I think his question is whether the successor has a right to that property. The answer is yes, by virtue of the Succession Act, and unless there is a will which is now willing it away to, because the will override the succession.
If the HUF receives gifts from non-members, then that income will be that gift would be subject to tax under section 56.2.10. Because 56.2.10 says only the gift which is received from relatives or on specified occasions would be exempt. Okay. So here the gift from non-members will be taxable in the hands of HUF.
Even if it is below the limit of 50,000.
No, can you please, come again?
So if a gift, we will discuss this in more details in the subsequent slides also, then I have taken a case study. When the person is creating a HUF or when the asset is considered as a gift, it is important that gift deed or FDTP should be there, and it should clearly mention that this gift is to the HUF and not in his, not as a karta or as an individual capacity.
even in case of gift from co-partner.
If gift from co-partner?
Because if deed, the deed, necessity of deed is not applicable in case if the gift is given between the family members. Registration of those things are not required.
Yeah.
So in case if the gift is given by one member, family member or co-partner to the HUF, in that case separately gift deed has to be
executed. It is advisable to have such documents because the department or income tax officer will try to assess whatever is, whichever is beneficial. So if you want to treat it as HUF property, it is advisable that you should have a document that this gift is to the HUF and not to the individual. Otherwise department may try to say that this is gift to an individual person and not to the family.
Co-partner contributing to HUF will be putting it into a hotspot. It is not a gift. Gift has to be before the HUF being formed. Gift has to be given, it has to be by a member of the HUF. To be formed HUF only can give the gift. Otherwise, it becomes part of property which is put into the HUF.
So, HUF is to,
has to be formed. Then only the gift, before that gift can be given.
So, on marriage, the HUF is formed.
Yeah.
Right.
So, in
when we are discussing about the gift, one thing is that a person receiving gift on marriage will not be considered as a income. So is that applied to HUF? So if the person is getting married, so at that time if the person is getting a gift, okay, so can it be considered as an individual property or it can be considered as a HUF property? So when a person is receiving gift at the time of marriage, the exemption from the income tax is also applicable only to that individual. You want to treat this as a HUF, it will be a taxable, plus you will have to prove that it is given to the HUF.
Then he will say, if I have to do, I take it as individual.
Yeah. So it would be individual. But people, generally people want to create the assets in the hands as a HUF property, corpus they want to create. So in that case, it is like, lot of precautions has to be taken to treat this as a HUF.
Individual account and put it into the HUF.
But then the clubbing provisions will apply. So if you are putting, taking in an individual and then putting in a HUF, the clubbing provisions will apply.
Only on the initial, not the income.
So we will discuss that. The other form of creation of assets is by way of will. So this is also like in lot of cases or courts have upheld that you can create a HUF through will, and it is not necessary that HUF should be in existence at the time of execution of will. So when the will has been executed, that person is not married. So even in that case also, it would be regarded as an HUF property once this person gets married. Okay. However, the intention, like in the will also, whether it is an individual, it is given to in his individual capacity or to the family, it should be clearly mentioned in the will. So will stating that I am bequeathing this my property to XYZ will amount to an individual. But it's, if it is said that it is for the benefit of XYZ and his family in future, so it will be a consider, it can be considered as a HUF, an HUF property. Then blending of individual property with the HUF character. So where a person throws his individual property into common hodgepodge, it could be regarded as an HUF property, but subject to clubbing provisions, which we'll discuss later. Joint labor we had discussed. The important aspect here is the member of doing joint labor should be of belong to the same line of ancestor. So it cannot be cross. Then partition of HUF. So on partitions, and reunion again, the earlier slides we had discussed. So any property allotted on partitions, it becomes partitions of the small, bigger branch to a smaller branch of HUF would be again a property of HUF. And property brought back by on the reunion of the HUF partitions, it would be regarded as a HUF properties. Now let us see the partitions, and this we are discussing under the Hindu law. So partition, as name suggests, it is a process by which joint enjoyment is transferred into several individual enjoyment. So once, as per the Hindu law, once you determine the share of each co-partner as on particular date, the partition is complete. There is no need that it should be by meets and bounds. So there is no requirement under the Hindu law that there should be a physical division of the property. Only the determination of share as on that day of individual co-partner would suffice. The partition can be of two types, partial partitions and full partitions. Partial partitions means it is partial as regard to a person constituting HUF or the properties belonging to HUF or both. So if there is a property, joint property, so you can partition for one, if there is a three houses and one house is partitioned or disposed of and given to members, each share has been given to members. So it is considered as partial partitions because you are not doing full full partitions. Still you are continuing with the remaining properties. Similarly, there are one co-partner can decide to go away from the joint family with his share in the property, and the remaining co-partner can continue with the property, with the family and the property. So in that case, it is partitions of the person along with the property. Full partitions means there is a physical division, and it has been physically divided, and it's not just jointly held, but it is a, there is a physical division of the property. Hindu law says that partial partition is valid. It recognizes the partial partitions also. However, Income Tax Act doesn't recognize partial partitions. Under the Income Tax Act, it has to be a full partitions. And we will discuss income tax in the subsequent slides. So under the Hindu law, what is the process of partitions? Co-partner can indicate that his intention that I want to separate to karta, and that intention can be in writing or orally by conduct. It doesn't require assent of other members. Even other members say I don't want partitions, but that other person wants a partitions and he doesn't agree, the partition has to happen. Then date of partition shall be the date on which the properties are physically divided. A request made at the time of death by a co-partner brother to his brother that you give my share or half share of my property to this person is not a partition, it's just a request made by a person that I want, this is my wish. So this is not a partition. The partition can be impacted mutually where the they divide the family property mutually as per agreed ratio, and in that case it ratio can be unequal. Okay, however, the assessing officer cannot consider that this partition is not valid just because there is a unequal division of the property. Even when the person or there is a karta who dies, in that case, the partition, it's not necessary that partition should happen. HUF can continue on the death of karta if there is other co-partners. Again, where the members of the family living separately, it's not necessary that all the members of the family living under the common roof. So it doesn't, if the, they are living separately, it doesn't mean automatically that there is a partition of HUF. Now coming to reunion. So in case of A.M. Vijaypuri Chettiar, the Madras High Court has given some prescribed conditions for considering as a reunion as a valid reunion. So reunion can take, and those conditions are, reunion can take place only between persons who were members of an HUF at the time of original partitions. A member of joint family once separated can reunite only with his father, brother or paternal uncle and not with any other person. There has to be an agreement to reunite. It is not necessary that all members who were on the earlier date members of the HUF is reunited. So there could be a members who can choose not to reunite and leave. Further, there must be a junction of estate or reunion of property and not just to agreement to live together. So again, that property should be brought back as a family property. But it is not necessary that all the property should again come back. Reunion cannot be made by minor because he is not competent to enter into an agreement. So these are basic conditions prescribed.
With his guardian? Last point?
No. In that case, they said no. The other aspects, whether what Karta can do as far as gift is concerned. So Karta of HUF can gift or alienate movable property to family members within the reasonable limit as a gift of affections. Now what is reasonable is not given. So it will depend on the circumstances and facts of each case and what the stature of the family is or what is the quantum of property family is holding. Now gift of whole or almost whole property to one son excluding others is not regarded as gift given out of love, out of affection. In that case, other members can contest this gift, that it is not a valid gift. HUF can give, Karta of HUF can give without the consent of other co-partner gift for the movable property for the purpose of legal necessity and benefit of the estate or support the family or relief from the distress or other act of duty, indispensable act of his duty. Even the person can give, Karta can give, give the property within the reasonable limit to daughter at the time of marriage or after the marriage. And he can alienate property for the marriage expenses also.
Is it his own share or
family? Family.
What the right co-partners will have?
No. So joint family concept is such that every right of education, maintenance, etc. It will be a jointly. So all this would be a joint.
Basically, co-partners right also be protected because a
cutter might
also.
So in that case, what happens is
the co-partner's acceptance is not required.
No. No. Yeah, but it's movable property. It has to be a reasonable.
Right.
But
co-partner is definitely getting affected.
Yes, but in joint,
I can't do anything.
In the family thing, it would be always like that because it's a person who wants to go for a higher education.
Because
the succession as now,
the
rights
of
the law, if the co-partner's interest is not protected, the time of partition, will the co-partner have a recourse of action to claim interest? So he can
claim
partition. He can say that, I want a partition right now.
How?
Okay. So he can claim partition.
It means with the consent of the co-partner only,
it
can happen through
Karta. Karta, as it is not required to take a consent or buying of the other co-partner, if he's acting in a reasonable limit, if he's biased, if he's biased towards his family and not others.
I think to say who decides the biased or unbiased.
It will be circumstances.
So affected party will have a right of course of action.
He can demand partitions.
Yeah, under HUF no partial partition is allowed. He can take it.
Yeah.
without family, without his without the consent of the co-person, he is baptized taking his own decisions. Covering under the gamut of interest, at the interest of the issue. The co-persons will definitely have their own laws because of this decision.
Only right
reasonable. Yeah. Reasonability is reasonableness is the yardstick there. So if it's unreasonable, then they can
stay. Yeah. Then only partition is possible.
Yeah. And as far as immovable property is concerned, yes, immovable property karta cannot gift or eliminate except for the pious purpose, and that too within the reasonable limit. So as far as immovable property is concerned, he require consent of other co-partners and buying of the other co-partner before gifting or eliminating that property. Karta cannot give to can make any gift to stranger. And one more aspect is karta, either karta or member cannot dispose of his undivided interest in the co-partnery property by way of gift, or he cannot assign his co-partnery share to somebody else. He can make will, but he cannot assign or transfer his co-partnery interest.
The gift to wife is gift to wife.
Which one?
First gift or allocation of over property. Wife.
Yeah.
HF property is given to the wife. Question of 64, all these things will not apply.
So when karta, it is coming from a HF. It is coming from HF, not as an individual.
It will be fully taxable in the hands of the wife. Because
No. Why it is taxable?
Sir, it is a HF property.
It's a HF property and
HF is not an individual under income tax.
Yes. How it will be?
It does not fall under the relative definition.
So we will see that in the subsequent, when we are going to discuss the tax aspects of gifts, we'll discuss more in details. Just to summarize, gift by karta to member, if it is within the reasonable limit, and then it is valid in the law. If it is an unreasonable amount, then it could be avoidable in law if the other person, like the sir has said, if the other person contests or says that you know he is not acting in the interest of family, so it can be, he can act, it can be avoidable or he can demand partition. To a stranger, it is invalid in the law.
Madam, this is what to the HF or individual, the gift?
Which one? The other important aspects which was subject to litigation in the past was whether karta can be a partner in the partnership firm. And there were a lot of debate and there was a lot of litigation around this area, whether HF can be a partner in the partnership firm. And finally, it has been rest aside by the Supreme Court in the case of Rasiklal and Son, 229 ITR 458, where court has said that HF cannot become a partner of a firm. However, karta of HF can enter into a partnership with outsider and represent the joint family. Okay. So as far as outside world is concerned or partnership firm is concerned, other partners are concerned, the karta is a partner and not the other members of the family are partner. So karta is only person recognized as a partner by others. Other members of family cannot interfere in the management of their partnership firm and ask them to show me accounts or I want to exercise the rights as a partner because the karta is representing in the HF capacity and I am a member of HF. So other members cannot do that. As far as outsider is concerned, as I mentioned earlier, it is the karta who is alone as a partner and not the family. Now let us take one or two this example. First is can there be a partnership between the Karta and Karta as a representative of HUF? So if both person, one individual is acting in a dual capacity, one is in an individual capacity and one is in a representative capacity. So can there be a partnership between such person, such entity? The answer is no, there cannot be such partnership valid, because for a partnership there has to be two or more person, and here only the one person, although he is representing in a different capacity, it cannot be considered as a partner. There has to be one more outsider to form a valid partnership. Can two HUF become a partner in a partnership firm?
Yes.
The answer is yes. Yes, as sir mentioned, two Kartas can enter into partnership and it becomes a partnership firm. So here again, like, you know, Kartas would be regarded as a partner, and to the outside world also, only that it is partnership between two Karta. And as discussed earlier, other members of family will not become partners, and hence they will not have a right to interfere in the management of that partnership firm. Now,
what about liabilities?
Of?
Liability of the Karta. Whether it will extend to even HUF properties?
Only HUF?
Yes. Yeah, because he is representing in the capacity of HUF.
No, he is trying to unlimited liabilities. Mm-hmm. It will become unlimited liability,
yeah,
of HUF.
Right. Because partnership is all the act does not, income tax act recognize HUF as a distinct entity. All other acts doesn't recognize HUF as a distinct entity. So especially the partnership act doesn't recognize, and hence it has to be through Karta.
Through Karta, to the extent of the Karta's property, not the individual capacity property.
No, I'm talking about the partnership,
yeah,
the forming of partnership
Karta's property. HUF property.
Not
Karta's property.
Right.
So let us discuss now income tax aspects. So as we all know, first and foremost thing is what is the residential status? Because the tax implications would be dependent on the residential status of HUF. So Karta's, how to determine HUF's residential status? So as per section 6, the control and management, where is the control and management of that HUF is the determining factor along with the residential status of the Karta or manager. So first we have to see where is the control and management, and control and management, if the control and management is either partly or wholly in India, then that HUF is a resident. If it can gain the status of non-resident only if the control and management is wholly outside India. So even if there is a part control in India, it would be regarded as a resident. And then we see what is the status of Karta or manager. If the Karta's resident status is ordinary resident, then that HUF also would be regarded as an ordinary resident. And if the Karta status is a not or Karta or member manager status is not ordinary resident, in that case, the HUF status also would be a non-ordinary residence. Now, what is control and management? Control and management has to be a de facto control and not just mere right to control. That is what Supreme Court has said. So, person should be exercising the power to control and manage. And if the Karta, it is generally Karta is supposed to manage the affairs. But in certain exceptional circumstances, he would have given certain powers to other co-partners, and such decisions could be taken by other person or other co-partners where he has delegated the powers. So in that case, it is still possible that we have to say that where is the control and management. If it is partly here in India, then still that HUF will gain the status as a resident in India. So let us discuss this case study. So XYZ HUF is having all properties in India. However, his karta is a US national and he is permanently residing outside India. And the sister of that karta is in India and is a part of HEF as well. And she is managing affairs of HEF. So in that case, what will be the residential status? Correct. Because even though the residential status of the karta would be non-resident, but your control and management, the powers to control is with the sister, and hence the resident status of that HEF would be regarded as resident. So even like karta sitting or the person sitting outside India would be managing, but certain powers or part power has been given to sister that okay, this share investment you manage. So even that part power or part control is with sister, and she is in India or her residence status is in resident. So HEF will gain the status as a resident here in India.
Power of control is given to a third party to manage
affairs.
Other than members.
As a managers, I have not seen. Now, this is where the person throws his self-acquired property into a common hodgepodge. In that case, what will be the tax implications? So we are discussing the clubbing provisions here. So when the person converts his property belonging to him into a common property, in that case, individual shall deem to have transferred his property to HEF. That is, it is to be for the purpose of holding for the jointly as a family. In that case, the income from that property so transferred shall be taxable in the hands of individual and not in the hands of HEF. However, the income generated out of that property, if that income is again reinvested and all that, if the income is earned, then it will be assessed as the income of the HEF. So at first point, it will be taxed as a individual income, it clubbing provision will apply, but income once it gets clubs, then on the second tier, there will not be clubbing. And on partition of among the members, where the property which has been thrown into common hodgepodge, on the partition, the spouse is getting this property. In that case, the income earned from that property will be taxed in the hands of spouse, subject to that 64(1) conditions. Now, as per income tax, what is the meaning of partitions? So, income tax act section 171 says partitions where the property admits the physical division of the property. That means where the property we can divide physically. In that case, it would be regarded. If the property admits the physical division of the property, the mere physical division of property without physical, mere physical division of income without physical division of the property shall not be deemed to be a partition. So there has to be partition of the property and not the partition of the income. And that partition should be by meets and bounds. And where the property is not, is such property that you cannot divide physically, in that case, to the extent such division is possible. So for example, business, if the HEF has a property in the form of business, so in that case, it is not possible to divide that business physically. In that case, what happens? You divide the share in that business interest. So this will be 20% would be held by this person by passing the relevant entries in the books of accounts. As we discussed in the earlier slide, under the Hindu law, partial partition is valid. However, under the Income Tax Act, it has to be physical division by meets and bounds. Partial partition is not recognized if it is made after 31st December 1978. And this is just to flood the leakage of revenue, because people were transferring the HEF property into a smaller HEF or individuals just to reduce the tax outgoes. So in order to plug the revenue leakage, this partial partition is now no longer recognized by the income tax. Even for full partitions to be recognized, it has to be by the order passed by the assessing officer.
Technically, no order is passed. Absolutely, no. I have not seen for the past
15 years
any order passed.
That is the requirement under the law that assessing, unless the assessing officer. It has to be passed by the law saying that he accepts this as a...
What is there just remaining in act when practically nothing is happening?
Yeah. So practically what happens is that like no person makes an application stating that there is
forced,
a full partition.
They should be forced to pass the order. Once in HF, they should make partition. Partition means then they should pass order. Otherwise, so far I am not seeing any order getting passed and won't say.
So under the law, it's the assessing officer's duty, which we'll see in the slide, that he is required to send the notices to all the members and satisfy himself that partition has happened. So that is the requirement. These are those few case laws in connection with the recognitions of partition. Basically what we discussed, the principle, the same thing has been discussed here, that it has to be, to recognize partition, it has to be a full partition. Partial partitions is not permissible under the Income Tax Act. Taxability of income or sum received on partitions. So sum received by a member towards his share as a co-partner of HUF on its partition is not taxable, and this has been blessed by the Mumbai Tribunal in case of Sudha Iyer, where she has received her co-partner share at the time of partition. So it has been regarded that it won't be taxable in her individual hands because she has received the income, the sum on the partition. Any sum received by a member out of the income of HUF is also not taxable. It would be considered as exempt under section 10(2). Where a person is receiving any sum from HUF, not as a member of HUF, but in pursuance of some statutory provision, then section 10(2) would not apply. And in that case, depending on the nature of receipt, the taxability will have to be determined. The exemption under section 10(2) cannot be denied for the reason that people are living or family are living apart, they are not living together, they are not under one roof. On that basis, exemption for the share of income or share of property received by a co-partner will not, the exemption would be, can be claimed, and assessing officer cannot deny that exemption.
During the year, income is earned. At the end of the year, you make a party and divide the member among the members of the family. So, 10(2) will get recognized.
I didn't got your question.
Income, sir. HF income,
yeah.
This year, this 1 lakh rupees income has been earned.
Right.
At the end of the year, you just divide among the co-partners, all the members.
Yeah,
you
can
clear
the section
10(2)
exemption, right?
Yeah,
because
it
cannot be treated as a partition.
It is.
It cannot be treated as a partition.
No, it's not a partition.
Distribution of it.
It's a distribution. Now, this is again the same thing what we discussed about the partial partitions. That assessing officer will not recognize the partial partitions and will continue to assess the joint, assess the property income which has been partitioned as in the hands of HUF, and it will make all the members jointly and severally liable for that income. Now, partial partition, like, you know, these are some technical benefit that partial, also the income tax says that partial partition cannot be recognized. It uses the word or a term that the, it won't be recognized if the HUF was hitherto assessed as an HUF. So if there was no, if the HUF is not filing any return, in that case it was not assessed in the capacity of HUF, and if that HUF makes a partial partition, it can still, we can, one can consider that it is a valid, and Gujarat High Court has blessed this view. So this is what the process has been prescribed for recording the full partitions. So when the full partitions happens, the assessing must claim that the full partition has happened by making an application to the assessing officer, and the AO is required to make inquiry and by issuing notices to all the members and record his finding whether he is accepting or rejecting the claim of the AO, claim of the HUF that full partition has happened. And in that case, all the total income of the joint family till the date of partitions will be assessed as a HUF income, and the all the co-partners would be jointly or separately, jointly and separately liable to the extent of the share in the joint family property. Now, coming to the taxability of remunerations, as we said, discussed, a person as a karta has a, can receive a salary or remuneration for the services rendered by him as a karta, or if he is representing the HUF in his as a karta capacity on behalf of HUF, and he is getting a remuneration from that partnership firm. So whether that partnership, the remuneration what he is receiving would be regarded as an income of HUF or as an income of an individual. Okay. So it will depend on the facts of each case. And Supreme Court has said that when the compensation is made for the services rendered and not as for the return of investment, if the person has become partner just because the HUF is making investment and then that partnership firm is compensating by way of remuneration, so in that case it is the income of the HUF, because what person is getting is not for his services but for the investment made by the HUF. So where the remuneration is for the services, special services rendered as a karta of that karta to that partnership firm, special services are rendered in his individual capacity, that's why he is getting this remuneration. In that case, it will be taxed and assessed as an income of individual and not HUF. And this has been upheld in the case of Bridgemohan by the Supreme Court. Now, coming to a second issue, where remuneration is received by wife of karta from that partnership firm. So in that case, whether it will be taxed in the hands of wife or it will get clubbed in the hands of individual. So 64(1) says that any income derived directly or indirectly by the spouse of an individual who is holding a beneficial interest in any concern, and from that concern, if the wife or spouse of that karta, or sorry, spouse of that individual is getting any remuneration, then it will get clubbed in the hands of individual. The only exception is that if the spouse is having technical and professional person, then in that case the clubbing provision will not apply. So here, in this scenario, where a person is a partner in the partnership firm and as a, not in his individual capacity, but as a representative capacity of HUF, in that case, if that partnership firm pays remuneration to wife, the clubbing provisions will not apply, because that clubbing provision applies to an individual and not if the person is acting as a karta in that partnership firm. And this has also been blessed by high courts, including Supreme Court. So we have discussed the taxability of remuneration. Now we will discuss what will be the deductibility of remuneration paid to the karta. So in case of Jugal Kishore Baldev, Supreme Court has said that if the remuneration has been paid to karta for rendering specified services and that remuneration is reasonable, bona fide and not excessive, and there is a valid agreement to pay such remuneration, in that case the remuneration paid can be claimed as a deductible expenses from the business income of that HUF. Now the second case is of Ahmedabad Tribunal, and this is the case where there is a partnership firm, and from that partnership firm, if the firm is making a payment as a remuneration to karta of that HUF, so will this remuneration paid would be regarded as a deductible expenses or no? So in that case, Ahmedabad Tribunal says yes. Even though the person is representing on behalf of HUF, but he is acting in that partnership firm in his individual capacity, and he is rendering services as a working partner, and hence such remuneration would be deductible subject to that 40B limit. This is 40A2 provisions. I won't discuss too much in details, but there is a provision all of us aware that if the payment has been made to a specified person by HUF, and if it is unreasonable, in that case 40A2A provision triggers and there would be a disallowance if it is unreasonable. So Supreme Court said that just to trigger this provision, the first condition test is that he should say that assessing officer should prove that it is the payment made is excessive or unreasonable. Coming to the taxation of gift or property received without considerations or inadequate consideration.
In the 40B, the remuneration is paid according to the provisions of the Act. In which case can the system officer say that it is excessive or unreasonable?
Because
according to the provisions of the Act, you are making the payment. In which case can the assessing officer say, it is excessive or unreasonable?
Yeah, because we have to go by that strictly by 40B. 40B provision, we say that it has to be in that percentage range.
Right.
But where it's not a partnership firm, it's a sole proprietor. So there 40B provision is not there. So there we have to see the reasonableness of that salary. So where HUF receives from any person without any consideration any amount exceeding 50,000, then whole of such amount or any immovable property and the stamp duty value of that immovable property exceeds 50,000, then that stamp duty value of that property or any property that is specified property, shares, jewelry, bullions, etc., and FMV of that specified property exceeds INR 50,000, then the whole of FMV of such property would be considered as a income in the hands of HUF. Where there is a consideration paid, but that consideration is less than fair market value of that property by an amount exceeding 50,000, then again that aggregate FMV of such property exceeding such consideration will be taxable as an income in the hands of HUF. Now this above provisions will not apply to HUF if any sum or property is received from by the relative or under a will. So if the HUF is received any of this money or property from relative or under a will, then such provisions would not apply. So here what we were discussing earlier, the relative's definition of relative has been amended to include members of the HUF as a relative. And however, the reverse is not reverse is not there. So there, where a member is receiving, this is what case law is, what we are discussing, in case of reverse scenario. So where a member is receiving property from HUF, in that case, one can argue that relating, although it's not given that HUF members relative will, or individuals relative will include HUF, but they have given the exhaustive definition of relatives of HUF, which includes mothers, wives, widows, unmarried daughters, etc. So the relatives is defined for individual, and HUF is also consisting of mothers, wife, daughters, etc. So the argument can be developed that HUF is nothing but a group of relatives, and hence this provisions of taxing gift would not apply. Again, the alternative second argument can be put forward is that the gift would be exempt under section 10(2) because I am satisfying two conditions. One is that I am a member of HUF and I am receiving this money out of the income of the HUF. Maybe taxed in the earlier year, not out of the current year, but I am getting this money from the HUF income. This gift I am receiving. So these two arguments can be developed and can be put forward for our case.
Only as a last resort.
Right. House property income, I think HUF can claim all the benefits like self-occupied property, one can treat one property as a self-occupied property, claim the deductions which is available to individuals like municipal tax, interest on housing loan, standard deductions, etc. Okay. Now the important aspect here is where the property, the considerations paid for this property, partly funded by individual and partly by HUF. In that case, that property would be assessed as a HUF property or an individual property. So the courts and tribunals have held that once you buy this property as a HUF property, and then the quantum of contributions made, whether it's a large or small by HUF or other co-partner, is not real. What is relevant is that you had bought this property as a HUF property and you had recorded that property as a HUF property, and it would be assessed as an HUF property.
Is it legal ownership of the HUF property? Has to be in the name of the HUF only?
Yeah. It's advisory.
Otherwise, bina by transaction,
yeah.
That will happen.
Yeah. Capital gains, again, HUF claim can claim various exemptions from capital gains. I will not discuss too much on that. Apart from the capital gain exemptions under various sections 54, 54BD, 54EC, 54AFG, 54GA and 54GD. What are other things which is like not applicable to individuals, like concessional capital gain tax rate in case of long term and short term capital gain, STT paid capital gain. The HUF also can claim similar benefits if these benefits are available to HUF as well. Index cost benefit, replacing cost with the cost to the previous owner, replacing cost with the FMV as on April 2001. These are all benefits HUF can consider while computing the capital gain. Just few judicial precedents which are in connection with HUF. So here, if the property sold is a HUF property, then the reinvestment benefit also you will get if you buy the property in the name of HUF and not in the name of member or member of the HUF. And where the payment made by the assessee for education or maintenance or marriage of his unmarried daughter through the consent and the decree, then such expenditure cannot be considered as a part of cost of acquisition or improvement or relating to transfer expenses relating to the transfer of property. This is applicability of deemed dividend. So as we all know, deemed dividend will trigger when the any payment or any loans and advances has been made by company on which public are not substantially interested. So private company, from private limited company is making a, is giving loans and advances to HUF in which the shareholder is a member and holding more than 20% share. In that case, such loans and advances given by the company would be treated as a deemed dividend to the extent of accumulated profit. So there was a case in case of S.M. Gupta where HUF has received loan from three companies in which it is substantially interested. Now AO has considered that there are four co-partners, four members, and therefore each member is holding more than 20%. So it's a substantially interested, HUF is holding substantial interest in that company, and hence this deemed dividend provision will apply. SSC was contesting that it's not only four members, we are 12 members, and it has included co-partners, other members, as well as unmarried daughter. Assessing officer was saying no, married daughters. So assessing officers was contesting that I will include only male co-partner and not female co-partner. So the in this case, Kolkata tribunal said that post enactment of Hindu Succession Act, daughters become co-partner in the HUF property, and it is immaterial whether on the date of enactment daughters were married or unmarried. So this is what we had discussed in the initial case studies. So even the daughter is married at the time of enactment, she could be regarded as a co-partner as per the Kolkata tribunal. And accordingly, if we include four male co-partner and two female co-partner, so each share co-partner interest is less than 20%, and hence 222 we will not have any applicability.
We have some time.
So then, so few aspects. Whether HUF can set off of laws of erstwhile concern taken over by HUF. So Section 78(2), which prohibits the carry forward and set off of losses of one person by another person, except when the other person receives this losses by way of inheritance. So in this case of Pratap H. Desai, what has happened is HUF was a partner in the firm, and that partnership firm got dissolved, and then that its business was taken over by HUF, and that partnership firm had losses. So that loss suffered by that partnership firm, the HUF entity has claimed set off of such losses. In that case, tribunal said that you cannot claim such set off. The second aspects we are discussing is for attachment or recovery of tax demand. So demand against the member of HUF can be recovered from HUF to the extent of its share in the property HUF. So if the HUF has a balance of 6 lakhs in its bank account or property of 6 lakhs, and the tax demand against that member in his individual capacity is 10 lakhs or 5 lakhs, in that case, suppose it's a 5 lakh, so in that case, assessing officer cannot recover entire 5 lakhs from the HUF account, because that person's interest or co-partner interest needs to be seen. HUF can be a proprietor, and all the provisions relating to proprietor, that it can have more than one proprietary business, and no tax audit if the turnover is less than 1 crore for each business entity, or where the business is subject to presumptive taxation, that if the turnover is 2 crore, less than 2 crore, then it's not subject to tax audit. This this is the taxability of capital gains. So where any distribution happens of capital assets on the total partition or a partial partition of HUF, then such transfer would not be regarded as a transfer. It would be exempt under section 47 and HUF would not be subject to capital gain tax on transfer of property on partitions. And in the hands of recipient, that is a co-partner, if the co-partner is receiving that property on partition, then again it can be considered as an exempt. The cost of assets in the hands of member would be the cost to the previous owners. If the HUF is having a dividend income, then from last year the section 115BBDA would apply. So if the person, if the HUF is receiving the dividend in excess of 10 lakh, then such excess dividend would be subject to tax at the rate of 10%. HUF is subject to alternate minimum tax if it has claimed the profit link deduction such as 10AA, 35AD, 80H, 80RRB, 80H to 80RRB except ATP. And second condition is that adjusted total income exceeds INR 20 lakhs. So if these two conditions are not satisfied, then HUF is not subject to AMT, alternate minimum tax, and alternate minimum tax would be at the rate of 18.5% plus surcharge, applicable surcharge and education cess. AMT credit can be allowed to be carried forward for the next 10 years and can be set off where the HUF is subject to tax under the normal provisions. Chartered accountant's report would be required to be submitted at the time of filing the report where AMT is applicable. To compute the total adjusted income of 20 lakhs from the business income computed as per the provisions of income tax, the deductions claimed under section 10AA or other profit link deductions has to be added back. And then we have to compare whether that 20 lakhs threshold is met or not. This around miscellaneous, I think in the interest of time, we can skip that HUF can claim various deductions under chapter 6A and is required to do TDS at the time of making certain payments and filing of return requirement, we can skip. If the assessing officer wants to assess the HUF, then the notice has to be served in the name of HUF. If the notice is not served in the name of HUF, or it doesn't specify that it is for the family, and it is it just gives the name that Mr. XYZ, and then later on realizing the mistake, he tells that person that okay, I want to assess HUF, and that individual agrees, even though mutually there is a consent to assess HUF, still that assessment would, can be void and invalid.
That number will be there.
Yeah.
That number will take care of.
Yeah. But this is just an illustration like how tax saving, because initially the people generally the basic, although the Hindu undivided family concept is coming from a Hindu law and it's a system personally we're living, but after certain point it becomes a tax saving instrument that people will form a HUF to reduce their tax outgo. So how it can happen or how it can be effective, it will depend on the facts. So if the person has a two house property, one he has bought and other he has received from his father, and the second house property fetches the income, for example it is 12 lakhs, and if he gives this property which he has received from his father by way of succession to his HUF, then the rental income earned would get clubbed in his hands. However, on the other hand, if the father has bequeathed property of his own under will to son, and then income is earned, in that case, there are clubbing provisions will not apply. So, but the important thing is that will should mention that it is gift or, you know, I am bequeathing this property to HUF. That's a very important thing. Otherwise, it will get again taxed in his individual capacity. So, in the first case where he has two properties and he is trying to give this property, one property to HUF, the clubbing provision applies. Hence, it's not very tax efficient. Whereas in the later case, it would be a tax efficient. Coming to the challenges, what we see as a HUF, and why this HUF concept is like, you know, becoming less familiar in the recent time. So it's more because of challenges. So challenges, one first challenge is that there could be a litigation in future from the co-partners who were minors at the time of partition. So minor, after attaining the majority, if he feels that partition was not to the best of his interest, he can go to the court and say that that partition was not in his interest and it required a relook. There could be a challenge while selling the property, immovable property especially, because the co-partner interest is not fixed, and who are the members. So when the family has an intention to sell that property, but the buyer always will have an apprehension that if there is a family dispute, then again after buying this property, I will have a hassles. Again, from a business community or HNIs, there is an apprehension that government will bring estate duty back. So, to avoid any hassles of estate duty or paying taxes, if the co-partner dies, so in that case, that co-partner interest again will be subject to estate duty. So it won't be a tax efficient. So in that apprehension also, the people feel that HUF would not work. Again, as I discussed, HUF is a fleeting body. So there is no definite share in that property. It gets fluctuated, it gets increased. If there is a demise in the family or one of the member dies, and it gets decreased if there is a new member in the family. Now, every person nowadays want to have certainty about the share, and family doesn't want any disputes as far as share is concerned. So this is also one of the reasons where, like, you know, we see the challenge, and people, business communities and HNIs are reluctant to now use HUF as a mode of tax saving or tax planning. Lastly, daughter becoming co-partner. So they feel that after a marriage, again the third person will have an interference in the family and there could be a dispute. And anyway, daughter has a right by way of Hindu succession. So in the business, I want to have a structure. I want to do a business in a more formalized way rather than going for a HUF. So I can set up a company where the shares or shareholding is definite, person voting power is definite, instead of going for a HUF. And the other small miscellaneous aspect that HUF need to have a separate bank account, demat account has to be opened for HUF. HUF can invest its money in shares and securities, there is no bar. And the HUF can no longer open a new PPF account after 2011. If the HUF is already having a HUF account before 2011, then it can continue till the maturity, but it cannot now open a new HUF, PPF account.
So maturity gets extended
out
in
5 years. So in that case, I think bankers are not allowing to extend. So 15 years is the limit till the PPF account gets matured. So after maturity, it's not. Yes, then I think the rest is the sections. So if you have any other doubts or if we have other questions or queries or practical aspects, we can, you can share, we can discuss. If I have missed anything, I think sir has more practical experience. Yeah, so it, there is no different implication, the implications remain the same. So the prime thing one has to see is whether the gift is from members or non-members. So if it is a gift from non-member, then it is a taxable if, in the hands of HUF, unless it is received as for a specified occasion kind of thing. And if it is from a member, then it is not taxable in the hands of HUF, but the income earned from that property would clubbing provisions would apply.
You know, clubbing provisions apply only when you get 650,000. Even from third party you get.
Yeah. So from third party if you get 2.5 lakhs limit, like you can consider this thing. So it is an income. First of all it will be an income.
Yes.
But of course you will get that all the benefits of slab deductions, etc. So people get do like no practically tax planning. By receiving gifts of 2.5 lakhs plus 1.5 lakh by making investments, so 4 lakhs goes as a tax-free.
One more issue, as we have been talking about resident, non-resident.
Yeah.
Son is a non-resident. Father, son is also having HEF
okay.
capacity. Father is maintaining his HEF account. Will it be treated as non-resident or resident?
So it is the father's HEF. So whose resident status we are?
Son's
HEF. Son's HEF.
Yes.
Okay. So the important fact, as I mentioned, where is the control and management lies? So if the control and management is with the father and not with the son, so if father is in India, father's resident status is a resident. In that case, it would be regarded as a resident.
But he is not part of the HUF,
yes,
the son.
But manager is there.
He's
a manager.
He's a manager.
Yeah. So
first thing what we are seeing is where is the control and management. The control and management, even if it is partly here in India, it would be regarded as a resident. The Karta's residential status would trigger only to determine whether that HUF is an ordinary resident or not ordinary resident.
Madam, so, did it have any implication about this double taxation agreement or something?
For?
Yes, HEF income.
Yeah.
Did it have any implication in double taxation agreement?
So, if the HEF status is an ordinary resident, then yeah, it is subject to global income. And if the HEF has an investment outside India or source of income outside India, then...
Yeah, HEF doesn't have any income outside India.
Okay.
HEF has got income only in India.
Okay.
It is managed by the father.
Okay.
So that's the only issue, whether it will be treated as a resident or non-resident in hands of...
So we have discussed that it would be regarded as a resident. So once it is regarded as a resident, treaty won't apply. Treaty won't trigger.
Madam, sir, that question regarding basic exemption. Now if the HUF is receiving a gift of 1 lakh from a third party, the amount in their amount is taxable in the hands of HUF at the maximum marginal rate, no?
No. Exemption provision up to 250 lakhs it will apply. When it exceeds only that provision. See, when the source is not explained, then 150
lakhs will apply. Well, there is a HUF in Karta, co-parcel spouse and the children. No? They can make one more smaller HUF? If yes, how?
So the first HUF consists of
Karta, spouse and children, wife, husband.
Oh, okay. Second HUF, how with whom they will form?
Because there is a concept of
smaller HUF,
right?
But the your first HUF and second HUF members will be the same, right? So bigger and smaller will be come where there are different members, like additional members. So in sorry.
The son get married.
Madam, so if the son is married, then you can have. Who HUF?
If son gets married,
son will have a separate HUF. Son can have a separate HUF. Oh, son can be part of the bigger HUF with his father.
Go there, they are staying together.
It's not necessary. Staying, living together or under one roof is not a condition for treating it as a HUF.
Man, like a professional income is not allowed in HUF.
Right.
So suppose I am practicing CA and I make a HUF. So what type of income I can have there? Because I have a professional restriction also.
Right.
That apart from house property.
Interest.
But for interest capital should be there.
You have to create an asset, the formation. As I said, either you can have a gift or will.
Like, see, if my wife is working and she is not a chartered accountant,
yeah.
And if some commission income she gets in the HUF, so will it be a problem?
How can she get a commission income?
Because she can do a business, like I only have to do that business, or she can also do. Like, if she done business, some business there in the HUF, it's not possible.
HUF can have its own business. It's not bad. HUF can have a business.
Business can be of a commission agent also.
No.
HUF is a profession.
It's not. That is individual capacity. See, commission is.
You have to render services, right?
Okay, services can't be the income in HUF. There have to be a purchase and sale, you are saying.
No, that is the business. Normally, HUFs are substantially having either interest income or house property income. These are the only two. 99%.
HUF can have a business income. HUF can have a trading income. HUF can have a separate business.
Professional income. See, somebody are commission agent who are not educated only, so they can't be called professional, no?
Right.
Their income right. goes under this only.
Business income.
So that type of business can be done, which is not professionally or technical skills are required, right?
No. Without
like commission, like you sold a flat, you don't need any skills for that.
That is individual capacity, not
individual
capacity.
When you are
like, so what services is rendered, it requires the usual skill set.
Okay, so that will go in her file.
In her individual file.
We need make any difference. The act we have been talking about hitherto assessed.
Right.
So where my HUF is not hitherto assessed.
Right.
So I can make a partition, partial partition.
Right.
In which case, after 1 or 2 years, it gets assessed. So that partial partition will get recognized.
Because it was not assessed. So partition has happened before that.
Yes. Right.
I have seen this situation where a single family having a husband, wife, children have got two HUF files. One is a bigger HUF and one is a smaller HUF. Is there any because I have seen the pen card where they mentioned so and so name in bracket smaller HUF.
Right.
So what is the provision and how is it really valid or?
The Bombay High Court said that you can have a bigger HUF and under that smaller HUF. So in the earlier your example also, the father, person, spouse, son, son's wife, children, that is one HUF. Again, son will have a separate HUF.
I am not talking about the father, I am talking about husband, wife, children. They have a two HUF.
He has seen only the PAN card, facts will be actually
different. Correct, no.
Practically
is telling. No, it is a practical.
I have seen many chartered accountants there. It is invalid then. They would have not declared all the.
It can create problems later.
When there are two family trees, which cross co-partners or members from this kind of HUF. The smaller HUF is made by the father and nephew or uncle, brother's son. Like that, the smaller HUFs were formed earlier. Now,
it may not be the same, right? He said that
it's not same. It will be named different also, like Satyapal Kapil Dev. That means Kapil Dev is brother's son.
Mm.
And Satyapal HUF is Satyapal's HUF. Correct. It is his own family.
Yeah, but
like that's a smaller HUF.
Bigger HUF, XYZ, smaller HUF, and the both HUF has father, wife, and
same members.
So that I think it's not possible. And if it is done, it's invalid.
I need to check with
state department has no knowledge that these things are going on.
The situation can arise also
barely.
It is good for us.
One day it's anonymous.
Then it became a problem.
So we said in a hypothetical situation what we were discussing, the son having a minor HF. Okay. Now the family is not there, the minor HF sustains. The bigger HF on incidence comes to the minor. So there are two HFs at the end of the day, after a period of time. I'm just saying a hypothetical situation when there is no partner, co-partner available on survival.
So it was initially a bigger achievement.
Yes.
But
yes.
The others have disappeared, so ultimately it is
same. No, it becomes individual then. It cannot be achieved.
The partial partition not allowed. Yes. So it has to be either total or nothing.
Husband and wife could be an HEF after this amendment.
Yeah, yeah. Even before amendment also, husband and wife HEF was possible. So what they say that like only one person should be a co-partner. So husband and wife without children also HEF is possible.
Ma'am, one question. After the death of a co-partner, can the wife of the co-partner claim the interest of the of her husband?
Yeah. So she will get equal share.
And
she becomes the karta.
As per the protest amendment.
If the son is minor,
then she is a karta.
Yeah. Otherwise, she is not qualified to become a karta because she is not a co-partner. But she is.
No, she is a co-partner.
No, she is not a co-partner. It's because of the amendment in the Hindu Succession Act.
She is a co-partner.
She is getting a share. She is entitled to receive a share if the husband is not alive and the partition happens. So in that case, she is
also becomes a co-partner, sir, not the wife.
Wife.
It gets reignited if she marries and then the HOF can be formed.
But then it will be different achievement. It will be different achievement.
Many SSC come to me and ask me to show some income which I am going to offer a tax for the tax above financial in achievement. There is no substantial proof for me to justify myself that the gift is actually received. So in case of the scrutiny, how it will be considered if
at the time of assessment, any gift received, you have to substantiate that it is a gift and that person who has given the gift is in a position, like, oh, he has that substance, he has that income to give you the gift.
But it can be Mary's anniversary or birthday of the kids or birthday of wife or spouse or anybody, but how we can say
it has to be reasonable. On a birthday, person doesn't get 5 lakh rupees from a stranger.
Not
the
entire amount, not from a single person. You can give a
15
names or
20
names or
30
names.
I think it will be suspicious.
What should we advise
the
client?
Above
20,000 they can
get some.
No advice.
Equities.
Then
who will spend for it?
Right one? Fine.
No advice.
No advice. No wrong advice.
As a chartered accountant, labor is our responsibility, we should not be.
Now 85% will be taxed. If you are not able to prove.
No, that is under demonetization. That is under demonetization.
Now also the provision is there.
78%.
It has been amended.
Amended.
Any income is not able to
prove. No, under income tax. Under the income tax.
If you have prepared for 85%, you can do all more whatever you
want.
Complete partition. Is that the consent is required of all the co-partners or the partition will go ahead as it is final?
Sorry?
I want to do a complete partition now. Say if you want to close the
office. Okay.
The co-partners are all sisters who are staying outside the state or outside the country.
Okay.
So it is not practically possible. As sir told, no assessing officer doesn't pass any order. What I am trying to tell is that in this case, now if the concerned karta whoever is carrying forward, he is telling I want a complete partition, I am taking the whole share into my name. So maybe 10 to gets exempted. But will the officer gets into the thing, yes, I need everybody's consent to take this as complete partition?
Yes. Did issue notice?
That was section 171(9) says.
Did issue notice to all the
members? He will issue the notice to all the members.
From where will he get those details? Because maybe wives and all are not at that time when the
fortune
was created and not available.
No, no, Sachin is supposed to give the
department.
Officer, where do you get details? You get details from any source? No,
you will
ask the
SSC
only to ask you the details.
He will issue a notice because when you are claiming that partition has happened, when you make an application, you will say that you know, these are the members of the family. So you yourself will give all these details when you are claiming this partition has happened.
So in the same partition, can we just practically take their signature and apply it up saying it is already agreed up and with the consent this partition is happening?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You need not wait till the assessing officer's order. Partition will happen. The only thing is that status of the assessing officer, to close that status, he has to do this.
Madam, did you come across in this years any order under
176? So it is, I mean, you should make an application. That's the suggestion, that you make an application and leave it to the assessing. So you have done from your side, you have informed, you have given all the information to the assessing officer.
Madam, son is separating from the father, one last question. Son is separating from the father without taking any issue of property, like whether it is a cash or a bank balance. So is it considered a deemed partition or not?
You are saying he has not taken any.
Nothing he has taken.
So when the partition, partition has to be with a person, with a person, right? With a property or person.
No, but like a joint family, father, the son, one.
So it will be a partial partition where the person goes and the other people remains in the family. So it will be a partial partition and won't be a full partition.
So partial partition should have any document proof or since he's staying separate, that's a
partial partition as such, it's not recognized at the income tax. So even the document is kept, the income tax implication there won't be a, it would still continue to be assessed as a joint property income. And in this case, he has not taken any property, so all the property is with the HUF. So tax implication will remain in the hands of HUF.
You said that HUF accounts will not be opened by HUF. Other investments can be done.
Yeah, shares, mutual fund can be done. So till 2011 it was possible, but after that amendment in the PPF Act, it is now not possible to have a separate account in the. Yeah, otherwise rest of investment is possible.
Section 80C, we can claim if excess of LIC or a question is paid by the individual, can we take
any insurance? So HUF can pay the LIC premium in the member. Okay. It would be best that it should be paid from the HUF.
If it is not paid, let's say.
It would be difficult. Then how will prove that the payment has been made by HUF? So it has to be made by the HUF. All the deduction is on the making payment by HUF.
Sir, I would really suggest you should relook at your client list and see how they are doing their accounting basically. See, the whole idea is that you should substantiate things with facts and it should be solid. Otherwise, no.
There should not be any ambiguity or suspicion.
Seriously.
See, one-off payment, in case of urgency, you can make from individual account and then pass the entry, it's okay. But if it is like, everything you want to do individual and as per your whims and fancies, you want to show that now this benefit I have exhausted, I want to claim this LIC in the as a deduction in HUF, it's not possible.
Yeah, it becomes very
easy.
You can plan 1 year in individual, 1 year in
HUF.
I don't think any restriction.
But if payment should happen from HUF.
Yeah, fine, sir. Yes.
He's saying payment won't happen that way.
How can you?
You just pass the entry, keep on passing the entry as per.
No, for JBA.
All suspicion. We should see that we don't create any.
So, client asks, I paid excess LIC here.
So we should have planned his investment in such a way. We should have taken policy.
Who is supposed to advise whom? Don't accept client's advice.
Ask client to seek your advice before they act.
Next year you plan in advance, that's all. One is gone.
Right. One is gone.
Pallavi, she's put in a lot of effort to get this up. I personally have learned a lot, and I hope all of you have learned as well.
Thank you everyone for patience listening, and even I have also gained a lot of knowledge and practical insights about HUF. Thank you.